So Ismail's ghost starts out as a spy comedy and becomes a love story and a drama and a film in a film. So there are so many lines in this story. And I was wondering how do you start out writing? How are there some starting points and then you let go and you let you drive, or how?
Actually does it work? Yeah. During the writing, I can't improvise that much or let it go, you know, because if you want to build the maze, it has to be built solidly. I mean, you have to make it solid, you know. So I think I knew that the beginning of the story, I knew that I would have bits and pieces about the life of Ivan. You know, the guy, is he a spy or a total idiot? We will never know. You know, so I knew that. And I knew that, you know, for the first time in my life, the main character would be a director. I knew that I wanted to make a film about a director once. Actually, it's not that pretentious. It's not saying he's a director. It's saying he's just a filmmaker. In French, it sounds even weirder. It's, je fabrique des films. You know, I'm making films, period. You know, the big director, it's, you know, Henri Blum. You know, that's the guy. He's much more humble with that. And I was trying to know something about this guy Ismail, who is writing the story about his brother. And I didn't know this character. And once, you know, I remember I met the producer, you know, at lunch, and I told him actually I had just this scene. And it was just four lines. You know, actually Ismail doesn't like to bath. He's not at the beach. And Sylvia is saying, no, how do you know that? Because I'm his wife. And I knew that he was this guy, you know, who was mourning his wife for two decades. And now I had the film, which were these three threads that I had to link together.
How did the ghost come up?
The word ghost, the thing that this guy is haunted, you know, mainly by Carlotta, but also with the love for Henri Blum, and, you know, and this figure of a brother who disappeared, and so he's trying to recreate something in fiction, and he's trying to fix his broken life, you know, with the bits and pieces and films, you know, and stuff like that, and this idea of another ghost who could be, you know, this, I like the bitterness of the last scene, you know, one could say, it's a happy ending, you know, because Charlotte Gainsbourg is pregnant, so everything is fine. But she has to kill her brother first in order to have a child, you know. So the disabled brother has to be suppressed, you know, from the painting, from the car, to make a newborn arrive, you know. So it was quite bitter in the same time. So it's another ghost, his brother, this crippled brother who is disappearing, and when you can see the last photos of him.
So you said if you build a maze, it has to be built solidly. And at the same time, I have the impression that's very intuitive, your writing. So are there, when you speak about ghosts, there are invisible forces, I suppose. Yeah. So are there the invisible forces that guide you, and then you let you be guided by the invisible forces?
Which I won't answer, you know, on this film, but on the previous film I made, which was called, what was the title in English? My Golden Days. You know, and I remember, you know, when we showed it in Cannes, you know, it was a young actress and her first appearance on screen, and the same, I think, for her lover, it was his first appearance on screen. And so we were in Cannes, and in the audience, someone said, you know, but it's improvisation. And I remember the pride of the young actress saying, no, everything was written, you know. And I like to share a feeling of freedom with you, even if it's a hard work to give you this impression of freedom.
There are already questions from the audience. There's one sentence coming up very often, I'm too old, you're too old.
Yeah.
So, it's a lot, this, all the stories are a lot about a too late. Is there another chance? Is there a possibility to start out again?
Yeah.
It's one of the main themes.
Yeah, I think it's one of the main themes, and that's why I was mentioning it to you before the screening, you know, this very American motif of a second chance, you know, and for Ismael and Sylvia, it's even the last chance. You know, and, let's say that you have a love story and it's a disaster. It happens all the time. No problem. We all recover. It just takes you 10 years. You know, yes, but it's 50. You know, so 10 years, you know, it drives him to 60. So it won't be the same kind of love story. You know, so it's, you know, so. And perhaps is it because my previous film was my Golden Days was done with a very absolute beginners, and it was about the first love. I did go on with the opposite idea of making a film with movie stars, you know, and about the last love, you know, the last chance that he can have. You know. Because in a way, you know, for Ismael, I guess it was comfortable to be the guy mourning his wife, you know, and the widower, the absolute widower. And suddenly it's uncomfortable, you know, because he meets Sylvia and it's a second opportunity. So will he grab it or not, you know, and will she be, I guess that Sylvia loved to be not in the stream of life, but to be just like a little bit beside, like a spectator. And she has to quit this position, to abandon this position, to reach another position and to be in the stream of life, you know, and she's scared because Ismael can be scary, and from time to time the gang can be wild, you know, and so will she dare to do it or not, you know, and so I think it's one of the main themes, this idea of the second chance.
Is there still
any
question?
It was clear for you which role of the women you gave at, because for me Charlotte Gainsbourg could have also played the other woman.
Absolutely, it was absolutely. I mean, each time that you are in front of such a problem of casting, I mean, you can switch the two names. It works, and it's a different film, you know, and. I guess that the two of them were surprised with my choice, you know. I can tell you, you know, why I did go for that setup, you know. Marion Cotillard, to me, she has this incredible power to reinvent herself, to bring to herself a consciousness. And I think it's a great gift for an artist to say, okay, I'm the own inventor of myself, you know. And so she can be, you know, in a big American movie, just after that you can see her in the Darden movie, and she's never the same, she's always reinventing herself. And this ability to build a myth, and to destroy that myth as soon as you are bored with it, I thought it was perfect for the character of Carlota, and I thought it was a perfect match with this woman who is running from one life to another one, to another one. And for the character of Sylvia, we have this expression in French, we say it's a fire under the ashes, you know. But you need to have a fire. And you, knowing how boldy she is, you know, when you think about all the Lars von Trier movie, etc., I knew that I would have the fire, you know, and that during the whole film I would need to yell to Sylvia, come back to life, come back to life. I know how vivid you are. You know, I know, saw you in Nymphomaniac. I saw you, you know, in Antichrist. You know, so stop to be that shy. You know, but her shyness, it was perfect. And the two women, it was fascinating for me to film them on the set, because it's two great major French artists, and the art in such different places in each one of them. You know. One is a pure animal, the other is full of doubt about herself, you know. One is the absolute actress, it's Marion, and Charlotte is always wondering, am I an actress or am I not? I'm a singer, but that I don't know. You know, are you sure? You know, because my mother was a great actress, am I an actress? Marion doesn't ask that kind of question, you know. She's an actress, period. You know, so the fight between the two women was absolutely perfect, you know. Not a fight, it's a friendship too, you know, in that ambiguous scene, you know, with the Bob Dylan, it's who wins, who loves, who lose, you know, you don't exactly know.
It's a very relationship between the two women you created. There's jealousy, there's attraction, there is respect, there are very complex feelings between them.
I think it's because, you know, there's nothing low in the sense that it's not, I want to steal your husband, is the situation makes that these two women are married to the same man in the same moment, you know. So it's not a question about, you know, I want to steal you something, you know. They are just the woman of the wife of the same man, you know. So they have something to share, you know, and so that's the awful situation that they have to experience in the island. You know?
Thank you. I just wanted to ask if the dance scene, which I loved, was improvised or it was according to your directions?
Same answer, that with the young actresses, I'm sure that Marion would be delighted that you could think that it was improvised, you know, because it's not possible to have that with improvisation. I remember one thing, no, so it was, we had a choreography, the choreography is, let's say 95% of it is created by Marion, and let's say that I have 5% of it. And I'm quite proud of my 5%. But I remember, you know, because in the script it was written that very song of Bob Dylan, you know. And so when we had a session with the choreographer, with Marion, I brought the CD of the In the Ate Me Babe, and I thought that perhaps it won't be provocative enough, you know. And I said, we will go for the Bob Dylan, did I say to Marion, if you can make it groove. You know, if not, we can pick up another song, which would be the 10 years after song, you know, which is in Woodstock, you know, I'm going home, and you know, with the electric guitars, etc. And Marion, I remember her face when she said to me, but I can make Bob Dylan groove, I can do that, you know, play the song, you know, I'll do it, you know. And so everything was choreographed, you know, with a wonderful choreographer, but Marion invented most of it, you know, but we rehearsed a lot, yes, we did.
I would like to hear your interpretation of this scene with different perspectives.
Yeah.
On the roof there with the alt pictures.
Just checking the translation.
C'est les perspectives.
Oh yeah. It's a dream. I made something like 30 years ago or something like that. You know, this idea, you know, I love the fact that the director is humble, but at the same time he thinks that if he could fix something in the history of art, we would have a better world, you know. And so he has this theory, you know, about the Van Eyck and the Virgin Maria, you know, painted, you know, by the Italian painter. Thinking it's not the same perspective, so it's not universal. Nothing is universal, you know. It's Europe is not one world; it's two worlds, 100 worlds, you know. And so, he thinks, and his friend, you know, Zvi Achomer is saying, don't play that kind of game with me. You know, I'm not a good Jew. You know, because his theory is, if there was so much hate in the Christianity, it's because we thought that we were one world. You know, and actually there was two worlds. That was he's trying to explain. And you know, and I love the perspective of the producer saying, are you not taking your work too seriously? We are just making films. You know, and that's his point. You know, just finish your film, that will be enough. You know, and that's the story and after. But we have a lot of stories about painting after that. You have this theory about Pollock, who was making figurative painting and not abstract paintings, you know. And so, yeah, I was playing a game, you know, with these images, in the images, you know. I was playing with these ideas.
So, what makes Sylvia return to Ismail? Because at the moment, he's self-destructing. How come she's not scared of him self-destructing? Does she see him as her last chance for love, or what was your idea behind that? Why does she return to him ultimately?
I think it's just the pure... In this film, I believe in the power of one character. I think they are all lost. All of them are lost. But I believe deeply in one guy. It's in Zvi Achomer. You know, as soon as I can see him, I can see that this guy has a magic power of fixing things, you know. So when I can see Mathieu, you know, tied to the bed, you know, he said, okay, I fixed the thing with your wife, everything will be fine, you know, because he knows that Mathieu will calm down a little bit with Sylvia. So to me, it was a plot, it's a plot from Achomer. It's V who brought up Sylvia back, and is magic, you know, we will find a way to finish the movie, we will find a way to tie the director, we will find a way to give him back his wife, and so it's going through this character, the reconciliation between the two of them. It's not just the two of them, without Zvi, they would never recover, you know, but with the magic power of Zvi, everything is possible.
Hi, I found your film really intriguing, but it received a lot of criticism, and I wonder what you say to your critics.
Just checking. The critics, oh, it was quite various. I'm just back from New York. The thing is that where it was, is it proper to speak it about? Yes, I can, you know, thinking about Hans, is that we had two versions of the movie, you know, and one is the version that you saw this evening with the version which was shown in Cannes. And we had a longer version, which is with more jokes and explanations and subplots and, you know, and even more tricky than what you saw this evening. And so each time that we had a problem with the critic with the French version, we were showing the American version, the longer one, you know. And so in order to fix the situation, you know. But unfortunately, you know, Hans not being here, you know, I couldn't fix the situation with the French distributor of the movie, you know, for you to show you the proper the proper thing, you know. I remember the wonderful trip to Tel Aviv, you know, where you have Blum and Ismael, both of them going to show the films of Blum in Tel Aviv. It's great scenes. You didn't see them, you know, but the critics saw them, I'm afraid they loved it.
About a director, to what extent are there autobiographic elements in the film?
I guess it's always more autobiographical than what I think, you know, but let's say that this character Ismail that we already explored in the film with Mathieu Amalric, which was called Kings and Queen, where we had a character who was called Ismail too. Let's say that Ismael is allowing to himself everything that Mathieu and I, we don't dare to do. You know, so that's why I love to film this director, is because, you know, I can't quit a set. You know, it's not possible for me to quit a film. You know, I'm too happy to make films, you know. So he's misbehaving, you know. I love the scene when he's visiting the apartment of Sylvia and testing the bed, you know, and leaving the room. I mean, he's so gross, offensive, you know, offending everyone. I love him because of that, because he dares everything that I don't dare to do. You know, he's our dream. He would love to be as wild as he is, you know, to take as drugs as he takes, you know, and to drink as alcohol. But I'm not able, I don't have the health for that, you know. So it's the dream of the, you know, the guy I would love to be, you know, the kind of guy I would love to be.
Ich weiß nicht, wo das Mikro ist, aber da hinten war noch eine Frage. Ja.
Merci. Bonsoir, je vais poser la question en français. Je voulais vous demander quel est le rapport entre Paul et Yvan Tedalus. Est-ce que c'est des mondes parallèles? Est-ce que c'est le même monde? Quelle est la relation entre les deux?
Ja, die Frage war, wie ist die Beziehung zwischen Ivan und Tedalus?
May I answer you in English? It's for the rest of the audience, or do you want to keep it private? I will try in English. The thing is that the two big scenes which are in the director's cut, you know, are one scene with the trip in Tel Aviv and the other about the hate between the brother and between the two brothers, you know, and how, you know, Ismael irritated his brother and is trying to depict a portrait of his brother who disappeared on the other side of the world. And so we had a long scene through Skype with the real Ivan speaking about his brother. And so without that scene, it's difficult for me to answer to your question. She saw the two versions, so she can agree, you know. And, but I love the fact to jump from one kind of storytelling to the other one. You know, perhaps I think that the opening of the movie of the film is what was the title of this Woody Allen's movie that I like so much? You know, it's Broadway Danny Rose. You know, you have a guy who disappeared. You know, he was an agent. He was famous. Everyone knew him. He was Broadway Danny Rose, and you have all these guys, the diplomats, telling stories about him. And I mean, you would have just bits and pieces, and the guy would be a sort of Bartleby kind of character, you know, the guy you don't know once again, you know, if he's an idiot or if he's so clever, you know. And so I love the opposition between the two characters, the two brothers, you know, one be so naive and the other being so cynical.
Yeah. I was a little surprised to hear in the audience some laugh when the Russian explodes with his cell phone. I wanted to hear from you, did you intend to do a comic scene?
Actually, it's awful in cinema when you can see someone, you know, if suddenly I fall on the floor and I hurt myself, you will laugh, you know. That's what we can see in the slapstick, you know, it's... So I think the fact of sharing a laugh about something as brutal is mechanical. It's part of life, you know. So I don't have to refuse this laugh. On the other hand, you know, all these stories about Ivan are funny. They are strange. They are magic. They are novelistic, and they are all based on real things which do happen in the world. You know, I remember when you had this guy who was killed in Vienna, I think, by the Russian secret service, you know, in the late 80s, you know, because he was from another republic of Soviet, you know, because and so you have these stories, or you have this guy who is trapped, you know, because he was one of the first terrorists in the world, etc. So you have all these figures which are coming from real world, but told as a fairy tale. You know, so I think that's why, you know, people laugh, you know, in the explosion of the head, you know, because it's a fairy tale, even if it's based on a real event. And I think it was the flavor I was trying to give to that story of Ivan.
Ich möchte mich recht herzlich bei Ihnen bedanken. Es gibt morgen, wenn Sie den Film noch weiterempfehlen wollen, am frühen Nachmittag um 13:30 in der Oranje noch ein zweites Screening. Und danke Ihnen für Ihre Fragen. Ja, grand merci à l'audition.
Danke schön.